Long QT syndrome is characterized by prolonged QT interval on 12-lead ECG that can induce a polymorphic ventricular tachycardia known as torsades de pointes that in its turn can progress to ventricular fibrillation. Clinically, torsades de pointes can produce a syncope or even sudden cardiac death. The diagnostic criteria is a prolongation of corrected QT interval greater than or equal to 480 milliseconds. Or a long QT syndrome risk score greater than or equal to 3 point. Long QT syndrome can be congenital and acquired. Congenital long QT syndrome type 2 refers to autosomal dominant congenital long QT syndromes without extracardiac manifestation. It is the second most prevalent congenital long QT syndrome, just after the long QT syndrome type 1, and accounts approximately 30% from all. Congenital long QT syndrome type 2 is caused by genetic defect of KCNH2 gene that is also known as HERG, which encodes the pore-forming alpha subunit of Kv11.1 protein of rapid potassium channel. So normally, KCNH2 gene coded Kv11.1 protein of rapid potassium channel, which in its turn provides outward rapid potassium current during the phase 3 of action potential. Therefore, if gene is defected, protein that is coded by this gene is defected too. As a result, we have loss of function of this protein as a decreasing of potassium rapid current. The extent by which rapid potassium channel is impacted in long QT syndrome type 2 is mutation specific. It ranges from the small reduction in current to nearly complete loss in rapid potassium current. For better understanding the role of rapid potassium current in repolarization phase, let's briefly remind normal ventricular action potential phases. You can skip it by using the time codes. Cells that are not excited has resting membrane potential or phase 4 of action potential. When propagated impulse come from pacemaker, the level of membrane potential reaches the threshold for sodium channel activation, and phase 0, that also known as depolarization, begins. Sodium current depolarizes the cell to positive level of membrane potential, that is around plus 10 mV. Following rapid phase 0, a brief current of initial repolarization during phase 1 returns the membrane potential to approximately 0 mV. It is caused by short-lasting outward potassium channel activation. The next phase is phase 2, that is also known as plateau phase. This phase is relatively long, is mediated by the balance between inward calcium and sodium currents and outward potassium current. Calcium currents flow through the special L-type calcium channels. Outward potassium current is represented by activation of potassium slow channels. These potassium slow channels activate slowly following phase 0 and increases gradually during the action potential plateau phase. Current that is generated by potassium slow channel is small and may even be absent in normal human ventricular myocardium, particularly at long cycle lengths. For example, in case of bradycardia develops. It assumes more importance as heart rate increases or during sympathetic stimulation, both of which increase the magnitude of this current and cause acceleration of repolarization. A small fraction of the total sodium current that has provided the zero phase also persists during the plateau phase and called late sodium current. The next phase is phase 3 or repolarization, which are provided by different outward potassium currents. The first current that is responsible for termination of action potential plateau phase is rapid potassium current. Rapid potassium channel activates relatively rapidly and maintains significant outward current during phase 3 of action potential. Rapid potassium channel pore is mostly formed by alpha subunit Kv11.1 protein, which is encoded by KCNH2 gene. Inherited loss of function mutation in KCNH2 gene are associated with prolongation of action potential repolarization and congenital long QT syndrome type 2. Important fact is that potassium slow outward channels are also active during the third phase of action potential. The last outward current that is involved in terminal part of repolarization is the inward rectifier potassium current. This channel can work in both outward and inward direction, which depends on the action potential value and action potential phase. But in the terminal part of repolarization, this channel provides the outward potassium current. Phase 3 completes the action potential cycle, with return to rest in phase 4, preparing the cell to the next stimulus. There are two important ion exchangers, sodium-potassium pump, which moves 3 sodium ions out from the cell. In exchange for 2 potassium ions that move into the cell. Sodium-potassium pump requires energy from ATP splitting. Another exchanger is sodium-calcium exchanger that moves 1 calcium ion in exchange for 3 sodium ions. This exchanger can work in both outward and inward direction, depends on situation. As you see, that number of repolarizing channels is greater than number of depolarizing. As a result, repolarization has built in redundancy or reserve to protect action potential against excessive duration lengthening. This phenomenon called repolarization reserve. So, in case when some current does not work properly, another repolarization current can compensate this issue by more powerful work. The reflection of the ventricular action potential duration on ECG is the QT interval. Therefore, this repolarization reserve protects against QT interval prolongation and consequently against early after depolarizations and triggered activity arising. But repolarization reserve has some regional features. Myocardial wall can be divided into 3 parts. The first one is part that near to epicardium. The second one is part that near to endocardium, and the last one is mid-myocardial cells, also known as M-cells, that is located between the previous two parts. Rapid potassium channel is distributed relatively equally through the ventricular myocardial wall. The number of slow potassium channels as a repolarization reserve unit varies quantitatively in different regions of the myocardial wall. According to this, the slow potassium channels are expressed more in epicardial and endocardial muscle than in midventricular regions. So, in normal condition, when all channels work properly, different types of repolarization currents provide the action potential with the normal duration in all parts of ventricular wall. In case of long QT syndrome type 2, when rapid potassium current is decreased by channel mutation, both subepicardial and subendocardial parts can compensate this by the more powerful activation of larger amount of potassium slow channels. As a result, repolarization reserve in these parts prevents action potential duration increasing and subsequently QT prolongation. But in mid-myocardial region, where number of slow potassium channel is lower, so repolarization reserve is lower too, and ability to compensate the mutation is lower. As a result, repolarization duration and QT interval duration will be much higher. Different action potential duration in different myocardial regions called heterogeneity of action potential duration. This action potential duration heterogeneity lead to prolongation of QT and corrected QT interval in resting ECG. And also, heterogeneity is one of the theoretical models that explains the low amplitude and beefed or notched T wave on resting ECG that is classically observed in long QT syndrome type 2. Another possibility is that the second component of T-wave is actually U-wave. Another important ECG feature is short-long-short cycle length seconds before the torsades depointes onset. When after regular QRS complex, premature ventricular contraction occurs, that designates the short cycle length because of prematurity. coupling interval is 0.7 seconds. After the PVC, we have compensatory pulse, which accounts the long cycle length, 1.1 seconds. This long cycle also prolongs action potential duration in the next complex, which in case of prior prolongation provokes early after depolarization formation. And if EAD will be strong enough, it can cause the triggered action potential that we see as short coupled premature ventricular contraction on ECG. Should be noted that on ECG we see prominent U-wave just before the short coupled PVC as a sign of early after depolarization. Once occurred, early after depolarization triggered action potential can provoke the additional triggered action potentials. These additional action potentials are represented on ECG as onset of torsades de pointes. So, as a result, in case of congenital long QT syndrome type 2, torsades de pointes is usually manifestate after the short-long-short cycle length sequence, when the first short is premature ventricular contraction, long is compensatory pulse, and the second short is short-coupled PVC. Now let's talk about types of torsades de pointes triggers in case of long QT syndrome type 2. Approximately 37% of fatal events related to the emotion, but usually not related to the exercise. Another 63% is associated with a sleep or rest without arousal. A relatively specific trigger of torsades de pointes in long QT syndrome type 2 is sudden loud noise, such as that produced by an alarm clock. In addition, both sudden noise and emotions possibly induce increased sympathetic activity, whether by neural or neurohumoral action, and predispose the heart to ventricular fibrillation, but the exact role is uncertain. Beta-blocking drugs help to reduce arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death in patients with long QT syndrome type 2, but less so than in long QT syndrome type 1. In the end, I want to share you the outline with comparisons of most prevalent autosomal dominant long QT syndromes. Link with full article you can find in description. If you like the content, press like, subscribe to our YouTube and Telegram channel, and have a good day!